Know what I mean?
Together in the November, then I came in the December. February and March, and the single was released in the April. We went over to London to a place called Tropicana Studios, was it?
That's yeah. Right, yeah.
To a guy called Ian Levine.
Turned around to our manager and said, the Blondie fella can't sing, throw him out of the band. Send me, and that was me, he told me, he says, the Blondie fella can't sing. So I says, I'm going to prove to him he's wrong.
That Love Me For A Reason was a... Again, we were guinea pigs in the music industry. We couldn't dictate what we wanted to music to release us, to say, you know, we weren't.
You were, right?
We didn't have enough experiences in the business to understand what direction to go in. So with management, which we thought he knew everything, but God, my God, when we look back on things, you know, we did a cover. It did very, very well for us. The reason we picked the Osmonds because he liked it as a tune. He reckoned it could be a hit, and he was right. And it went from there.
Love Me For A Reason in 1994 launched the Irish pop group Boyzone. But there's a lot more to the birth of the band.
I didn't know any of the rest of the lads, and yeah, I did audition for the band, in a way, but Louis kind of knew already who he was looking for and what he was looking for previous, so although we went through the steps of auditions, we were fairly confident. Just across the water here, there's a place called the Ormond Centre where we used to meet during the week and just sing along to some tracks or whatever, just to get to know who was the stronger singers and stuff like that, but never anyone telling us what to wear or what to say or what to sing or how to sing, you know, none of that. First record we ever did was Work More About You, which was just a domestic single there that we put together ourselves and paid for. We didn't have a record label at the time, and then Polydor thankfully came along. And it was tough, it was a lot of work, but we got number three in the charts with it. And it just built from there. We didn't release Work More About You anywhere else except for Ireland.
I'm still at school, myself and Roman were still at school studying. I think it was 3 months to go into doing my final exams, and I dropped out to join the band. I studied acting for a long time. I studied acting. I'd done a play when I was 16, and that was staged down the road in a theatre. I'd done a lot of dancing. I won a lot of dancing competitions. And, but I never really sang that much, to be honest with you. I always liked to sing, and I knew I could sing, but not to the extent that to be in a group, you know. I always grew up with Ron, and Ron was a good friend. We actually walked around the park from each other during the summer times. He walked into the shoe store, and I walked up down in the clothes store. And then there was Shane. I met Shane at a lot of dancing competitions. You know, his whole family was involved in that. His mother doing costumes, and his sisters were all great dancers. So I met him through there, and we got on very well. And then Keith, I met Keith, and he was just mad. He was wild. And Mikey actually, gave me a drove. He drove me home one night from the auditions, from when we all got in, and he drove me home. So I got on well with him.
When we first got together, I was partially in college, just on a one day, because that's what an apprentice mechanic has to do. That's what I was doing at the time, working with my old man. I served my time and all that, so if it all goes wrong for me, I'm still all right. Like, I left school, if you're going to say age, is 15, and I started to work for my dad, and I was already earning my own money, you know, I was being my own person, had my own life, and I had my own cars, I had everything. And this was just another step in life, as to say, that was going to earn me more money and have better cars and a better way of living.
I was kind of between things at the time. I had just left college. I was in college doing architecture, and I just completed the first year, and it started back in the second year that September. And I ended up leaving for a couple of weeks and went off to Greece with a few friends for 2 weeks and went back to college. And when I went back, I wasn't into it anymore, you know. My boys I got together, I was a bit, I suppose, all over the place, to be quite honest. I was involved in all sorts of different things, you know. I used to do a lot of training at the time. I used to work out in the gym. Every day of the week I'd be in the gym, to be honest, you know. And as you probably know, once or twice I've done a bit of stripping for the ladies' clubs. But it was then just to make a few pound at the time. I used to train in the same gym as Shane. And I remember one day opening the Evening Herald, the national Irish paper, and I saw a picture of Shane inside telling about what he's doing this group and the band. And I said, geez, I'd be really into that. I'd really like to do that. And how am I going to go about it? I don't know. So it was a coincidence the way it happened. I was in a club one night in Dublin, dancing away, doing my usual thing. And I was approached by this man that I'd never met before. And he asked me, could I sing? And he said, would you be interested in being in the band? And I said to him, this wouldn't by any chance be the band that Shane Lynch is in, is it? And he said, it is. I said, that's funny. I said, I grew up around the corner from Shane. I know Shane very well. So that meant for a good relationship already. So he was quite pleased at the fact that I knew Shane. So obviously we met up with the lads and got together.
In the whole process of, you know, Boys Own coming together, it wasn't straightforward. Eventually, after between some of us knowing each other and auditions and all kinds of stuff going on, it had been narrowed down to seven people, and I wasn't one of those. I was kind of the eighth person, so to speak. You know, there was a time I was told I was in, and then I wasn't in, and I was, and I wasn't in. You know. But, you know, I didn't really mind at the end of the day. You know, I was quite happy with what I was doing. I'm a motor mechanic by trade. I had a good job, and I was playing guitar and lead vocalist in a rock band at the time. So, you know, there was no skin out of my nose whatsoever if I didn't get in, so I didn't. How can I try to explain when I do, it turns away and it's always been the same. Same old story. A couple of months after, I had kept in contact with our manager, Louis, about getting some gigs for the other band that I was in. And he was helping me out there. And then all of a sudden, something happened that two of the guys didn't fit in anymore. So he asked me if I'd be interested in going into Boyzone. And I didn't really know what to say, you know, I wasn't really sure. So I think I just kind of put blindfolds on and says, all right, I'll give it a go. Ended up giving up my good job and everything else around me and went straight into it, you know. We're gonna
be so good. Boys Own were straight into a top pop career with their first album, Said and Done, which gave them the hits Love Me For A Reason, Father and Son and So Good, although the band aren't convinced that the album itself was so good.
Now, we were quite proud of it at the time because it was good for us at the time. We had a lot of songs on the album, like the likes of Together and Here to Eternity and really up-tempo kind of songs. So we haven't really done since, to be quite honest.
Here to Eternity on that album?
That was a B-side, but it was in that area, wasn't it?
All right.
So, anyway, it was a good album for the time and it launched us into the music business and it kind of got us in touch with the music business and how to, you know, the ins and outs of what to be doing. And basically it gave us the confidence to go on to do what we've done since. And it gave us the experience then of touring that album. The first concert tour that we did was on that album. So yeah, it was a great stepping stone for us.
The biggest worry for us was our second album releasing it and hoping it would do as well as the
the previous album because that was a number one. So we had to match it, and luckily we did with a different beat. It went straight in at number one. And in its first week of sales, it had doubled what Said and Done had sold in its first week of sales. So straight away, we had bettered ourselves.
Smile, an everlasting smile. A smile can bring you near to me.
We learned a lot through it. After Said and Done, you know, after that was released, we went in, we worked with a lot of different producers. We wrote a lot, and we co-produced on this album as well, some of the tracks, which was a different experience for us. And, you know, it is a very different album, and people can see that. And the media actually thought it was a good album as well. They gave us good reviews on this on Different Beat, and the fans actually, you know, all said that they really enjoyed it as well. That made us pretty happy as well.
On the latest album in particular, Ronan has written most of the material on this album. Mikey has written a couple of songs on the album, and Stephen has also. Myself and Shane, unfortunately, haven't written any on this album.
I know, judging by us, you wouldn't think it was a more mature album, but it is, honestly.
Musically, Mikey.
Musically, it's a more mature album. You know, between the writing of the last album, A Different Beat, and this, a lot of things have happened to us all. In different areas of our lives, and that's where we kind of gain inspiration from to write a lot of the songs that are there, you know.
So it's a bit of a deep album, you know. Right then, Ted, I'm off.
Don't worry, the boys aren't going anywhere, because coming up in part two, Boyzone tell us why they hate making videos, why they love touring, and just how lucky they are in love. That's all in the Essential Boyzone.
On the first day of Christmas, my true love gave to me a kiss under the mistletoe.
Hello? Hello. Merry Christmas.
Happy New Year.
No? Merry Christmas first, then Happy New Year after.
Yeah, y'all, this is Jay-Z wishing MTV and you in the UK, you know.
Right. Don't use that as outtake.
All I want for Christmas is a brand new band. A brand new. Anybody want to be in my band?
I've done TV before. You don't seem to realize.
Yeah, y'all, this is Jay-Z and I'm wishing that too.
All I want for Christmas is a brand new Nicole.
Merry Christmas.
Happy New Year. Happy New Year.
Happy New Years and many more, you heard? Peace.
Happy New Year!
Merry Christmas!
Now, boys, don't get into any trouble while Mommy and Daddy are gone.
Hate videos.
Hate videos. Boring.
It's just the waiting around.
It's just the
monotonous.
Frustrating.
And it's even more frustrating when the producer or the director or whoever happens to be involved with making a video doesn't understand the group enough to, you know, how can I say, to move your career on with a video. Because, you know, people just want to get money in the back pocket and make another video.
They just see the one thing, the boy band thing, and, you know, they think, oh yeah, just do a boy band video, there's not much to do on that. But we're not just...
We have had some good videos. Isn't it a wonder and a little baby
cries? Isn't it a wonder with the sweetness in my eyes? I think it's only one of the best because you have to go to Australia. Desert and we had cars and motorcycles. And
yeah, that was a brilliant trip. That was
a lot of fun. On our way out, the engine failed on the plane, and we had emergency landing in the desert. But we were all right. Opened a tray of beer on the runway and waited for the next plane to come along.
Let's not forget this place. Let's not neglect our race.
You shot that in front of a blue screen and they superimposed us as if you were an athlete.
I'll tell you the truth, right?
No, you won't, I will, because it's my question.
We hadn't got the time to go to Africa. We were supposed to go to Kenya or somewhere on safari to do the video, and we didn't have time, right? So what did the record company do? The geniuses that they are, they put us into a studio in London with a blue background, and then sent the crew out to Kenya, superimposed.
For 2 weeks holiday.
Oh, multi-exposure.
Multi-exposure. Put all these kids running among the race behind us, you know what I mean?
The latest video that we just did, it was a rush job because the single that we're releasing, we didn't know we were going to release it. It's not on the album. It was just, there was such a want from the fans after listening to it on the radio. We decided to release it.
No matter what they tell us, no matter what they do, you're the end of every, girl, you're all that I need.
Touring is definitely the best part of being in Boyzone, you know. It's our chance to get back to the fans, what they give to us by buying our records.
Although at the start we did have a great laugh. I mean, travelling around Ireland with a little white transit fan and doing very small gigs, and we did have a laugh. I mean, we got bottles thrown at us.
Yeah, it was a great crack getting bottles thrown at us. Loved that.
But just all the stories that we had going back then. Now it's so much different. It's so much better. I mean, you're playing to a big audience.
Belfast is a great place to play. Belfast, Scotland, Dublin.
Belfast and Scotland is probably the best.
I think Wembley as in hype, but
Manchester's a good
gig. Boyzone have just finished a UK tour and are hoping to continue with a series of dates across Europe and the Far East in the new year.
Bali.
Lovely. Bahrain.
Bahrain.
That's a lot of nice places. It's always
great to come home, though, I have to say, you know. Yeah. For me, there's nowhere like home. There's nowhere like Dublin in Ireland. We travel around the world, like beautiful places like Bali, but to be honest, I wouldn't like to live there. You know,
it's nice to visit.
There's all those lovely places to visit, but there's nowhere like home. It's such a brilliant place. Love it.
I live 5 minutes from the Point Everon, and I used to go down there as a kid, and used to buy one ticket for 20 kids, and one kid would run in, and then the other one would push the door open, and the rest would run in.
Just and, give us an L chain off your neck there.
Actually play there is amazing.
I don't think success has changed enough. We're still very grounded, you know. We're not pop stars enough. We're still very grounded.
Boyzone have worked hard to achieve success in the last 4 years, singing in Spanish for their fans in South America and teaming up with French boy band Alliage earlier this year on Working My Way Back to You.
We asked by our record company if we would do this. They reckoned that it would enhance our sales in France and popularity.
We sold 130,000 albums off the back of this single, basically, so for us it was a great move.
And that was the different beat album. The new album's doing very well there as well.
Success has so far escaped Boyzone in America. Although they have done some promotional work there in the past, it's still an area they have to conquer.
We haven't been to America yet. We've been there, but we haven't.
Well, that's what I mean, as in promotional-wise. We've just signed to Mercury now, so hopefully we can... Hopefully we can sort it out and that, you know.
It's been a successful and busy year for Boyzone, but Ronan still found time to be Grand Marshal at this year's St Patrick's Day parade in Dublin, accompanied by Keith in the Ford Mustang the lad bought Ronan for his 21st birthday in January.
It's an honour, you know. This is our hometown, this is where we come from, and you can't ask for a greater honour than this, and I'm chuffed.
Then there was the opening of Harrods Summer Sale in London, where the band couldn't help playing one of their famous practical jokes.
BP Fallon. We came over to Harrods, he's a good friend of ours. And we planted this stuff in his bag, silverware from one of the tables or whatever. And the head of security was going around with us, and we just tapped him on the shoulder and says, check out your man's bag there, you know. We reckon he's after policing the joint. So he checked the bag and he found the stuff, and like, he goes, why would I put that? Why would I do that? We were killing ourselves down the corridor laughing at him. It was one of the funniest things I've seen.
There was another honour for Ronan when he was awarded the title Spectacle Wearer of the Year in Britain, even though there's nothing wrong with his eyesight, proving it's cool to wear glasses. Success for Boyzone has come most recently from their third album, Where We Belong, which was launched in London in May. It includes the hits Baby Can I Hold You, All That I Need, and the current single No Matter What, which seems to have given the band a whole new audience.
No matter what they do, no matter what they teach you, what you believe is true.
It's taken from Android Webber's new musical, Whistle Down the Wind. We got the opportunity, we were asked to, would we like to sing? Tina Arena done a song. I think Tom Jones is going to release a song from it as well. And we were asked to. It's just an opportunity. I always wanted to work with Android Webber. I'm a big fan of all his stuff. And it was great to actually be in the studio, and he was there while it was being produced. And we're always there. And we got the opportunity to work with a guy called Jim Steinman, who produced it. Which is an amazing producer. And now it's a single.
The album Where We Belong features a track which for the first time has Mikey singing lead vocals. Good Conversation, which Mikey also wrote, has a very different Boyzone sound and shows off some of Mikey's hidden talents.
The public never really knew an awful lot about me, and I consciously did that because it's saving her up, really, you know. It's saving her up when I do my own thing, you know.
And there's been further credibility for the band with an appearance in U2's latest video for The Sweetest Thing.
You know, it's an honour for us, lads, to be involved with the U2 fellas, you know what I mean? We've met them a few times, and we've had a few drinks, and we've been out, and we've had a few parties, and they're a great bunch of lads. We seem to get on very well with them, so we like to think that they like us, so that's what they've asked us to do.
It's been a successful year for the band away from the music too, with three members tying the knot. Shane married Eternal singer Esther Bennett, then Keith went to America for a Vegas wedding with his longtime girlfriend Lisa.
I was engaged for 2.5 years, you know, and I had a 2-year-old son, and it was about time that, you know,
she gave him a box and said, get into that church, you.
No, I surprised her. She didn't even know. It was a surprise.
But it was Ronan who surprised everyone by marrying model Yvonne on the Caribbean island of Nevis.
It was a shock to me.
It was a shock. Nobody knew. We just didn't tell anyone. I didn't want anyone to know.
I got a phone call saying, Ronan says, will you ring him immediately?
He thought there was something.
And what's wrong? You know, I got on the phone and I say, bro, Steve, you know, what's the story? He says, I got married. I said, what? I got married. I said, what? I said, what about 10 times? I couldn't believe it. I was just shocked.
Proving that they're definitely not boys, the surprises have continued for Boyzone fans with the news that Ronan and Yvonne are expecting their first child in March. For heartbroken Boyzone fans, don't worry, there is still one member without a partner.
I'm not ready, you know what I mean? These are very lucky that they've met. They're soulmates, you know, I'm very pleased with them. And, you know, it's only a matter of time before I meet somebody that is, for me, the right person for me. You know, when it happens, it happens.
And what about the prospect of any little Lynches?
It boils down to Esther being in a band, and, well, mind you, me as well, but I think it would be harder for her, as in she gets to carry the baby. But please God, soon enough.
We are career women and we love what we do. I mean, it's not going to be a case of I'm going to neglect. Work. Yeah, I'm not going to neglect my family life, but at the same time, they both have to work with each other. If Whitney can do it and endless amounts of people can do it, so can we.
Boyzone are planning to release a Greatest Hits album soon and some new material in 1999.
Because the sales on Where We Belong is going very well, and they reckon that, you know, that'll just stretch past Christmas anyway, that we're going to leave it till about March or release that.
Yeah.
And then hopefully we should have or be near completion of the fourth album.
Boyzone showed their acting potential alongside Mr. Bean in the video for Picture of You and are considering making a movie themselves.
And it wouldn't be like the Spice Girls movie, it would be more kind of a real life commitments type of thing, I guess. But I think it'd be very, very funny. With five of us, the stories that we can come up and recreate in the movie would be just hilarious.
Boyzone just missed out on the best pop prize at the 1998 MTV Europe Music Awards in Milan. Of course, Boyzone are no strangers to the awards. They performed alongside Peter Andre in London in 1996, and Ronan hosted the show last year in Rotterdam. With their latest single, I Love the Way You Love Me, a contender for the Christmas number one chart position, you can expect a lot more from Boyzone.
We have, from day one, gone beyond everybody's expectations, as a band anyway. And, you know, we still will go beyond the expectations of these boy bands, as they're so called. Yeah,
you don't see any reason why we should finish up now, you know.
That's all that matters now, no matter.